Thanks for joining us at 5. A warm and sunny Saturday helped kick off the Portland Pride Waterfront Festival. Tens of thousands are expected to visit downtown Portland leading up to the parade on Sunday. Let's start with meteorologist Joe Ranieri this afternoon. And Joe, what will conditions for the parade tomorrow be like?
Well, I can tell you conditions are really going to be improving. Now, we're not going to be seeing that weather impact alert in our area heading into tomorrow. We'll still be impactful, though, heading into the east side of the state. But one thing that we're going to be running into, which we haven't seen much of any so far this month of July, measurable amount of rain. That's going to be coming late tonight and into tomorrow. Right around the parade, you'll be looking at mostly cloudy skies, and those clouds will lift by the later part of the afternoon, early part of the afternoon. But some models are suggesting that not only could we be seeing some scattered showers, light scattered showers heading into tomorrow morning and into the overnight hours, but also a threat of some thunderstorms. I think for the most part, there's going to be a slight chance, and that's going to be along the central and southern part of the Oregon coast. But as we head into later part of tomorrow and Monday, we're going to be seeing a lot of sunshine, but we still have some watches and warnings. Heat advisory is in place throughout parts of the metro area. That's that orange color. Meanwhile, that red color you see is the red flag warning in place. That's where areas could be seeing some thunderstorms develop late tonight and into tomorrow. We also have that excessive heat watch throughout the central and eastern side of the state. But this is what's going to be coming our way heading into the overnight hours. That's more of an onshore flow. We'll be seeing some cool and cloudy conditions to start things off your Sunday morning. But much of next week is going to be probably one of the more comfortable weeks we've seen so far this month. I'll talk more about that in just a few minutes.
All right, Joe, thank you. A lot of folks looking forward to that. Thank you. A Portland park once riddled with drug activity and crime is now on its way to making a comeback. Our Sydney Dorner spoke with city leaders on their continuous plans to revitalize downtown Portland and this project's ties to Pride. Sydney.
John, Darcel 15 Plaza has gone through many changes over the years, originally known as O'Bryant Square. Today, the city started construction on the site that's expected to open next summer, with plans of being an honorary place for the world's oldest living drag queen, while also creating a green space to attract more people downtown.
It means everything to our family. This is something that I wish he could have been here to witness. This would have been honestly, the icing on the cake to his career, his long career.
Meredy Woodson emotional at the groundbreaking ceremony for a park that will honor her dad. His name was Walter Cole, but on stage he transformed into Darcel, a well-loved and well-known drag queen that dazzled crowds for 56 years before his passing in March 2023. Today, his friends kept his legacy alive, putting on a drag show at the announcement that Darcel 15 Plaza will open up next summer.
He would be so thrilled. This is such a beautiful, large space. You know, once they cleared it out and did all the excavation, it's a really huge block. Darcel would love that his park is going to be bigger than ever.
The area was formerly known as O'Bryant Square off Southwest Harvey Milk Street between 9th and Park Avenue. In July last year, Portland City Council voted to recreate the space, with sketches of the site featuring a stage, wall of fame for prominent LGBTQ plus leaders, and even a spot to display artwork.
It's really just a perfect location.
City Commissioner Dan Ryan led the vote for the park to be renamed and rebuilt to honor Darcel and the queer community.
Be a place for people to have a little bit of a rest, to sit down on a bench in the shade. There'll be a dog walk here, but primarily they're for activation. It's to bring people together in entertainment. And Portland has so many performers that need a venue to perform in. And so we'll provide that in a wonderful, elegant, playful space.
Very fitting for the park opening to be announced the same weekend as Portland Pride. Mayor Ted Wheeler says he hopes the Darcel 15 Plaza coming next summer will be a symbol of acceptance and inclusivity. John.
All right, Sydney, thank you. Very cool story. Well, now to some of tonight's other top stories. Two people are hurt but are expected to survive after a drive-by shooting Friday afternoon at a North Portland park. It happened just after 4 at Dawson Park. Officers responded to find one of the victims. The other went to the hospital on their own. The suspect or suspects fled before officers got there. Investigators found more than 70 shell casings at the scene. Anyone with information is asked to contact Portland police. One person is stabbed, two others are shot, but no one arrested after a domestic incident last night in the St. John's neighborhood. Police were called twice to the area of North Fessenden in Macram Avenue. They say the first time a woman was reportedly stabbed by her boyfriend, who left the scene before officers arrived. Then they were called back after a neighbor shot at the stabbing suspect, hitting him and her boyfriend. Both men were hospitalized with serious injuries. The neighbor is cooperating with police. Both incidents are under investigation. Now to an arrest in the murder of a Salem father of three whose body was found in May along the side of I-5, and it appears the suspect is a teenage girl. Catherine Cook spoke with a close friend of the victim. He says, while unexpected, he's relieved investigators never gave up their search.
Our whole wheelhouse is definitely baffled by, you know, how this even happened and why.
Michael Kirchhoff continues to grieve the loss of his friend, Oscar Lizardo Chaidez. The 42-year-old father of three was found dead last May. Police discovered his body along I-5 South near the Charbonneau exit. Investigators ruled it a homicide. Now, nearly 2 months after his death, an arrest in the case. Oregon State Police tell KGW they arrested a female juvenile. The Oregonian identified the suspect as a 17-year-old. Citing Clackamas County juvenile court records, it said she's facing charges of second-degree murder and use of a dangerous weapon.
The detectives did their job, and they cared enough about a person of color that's gone. I mean, not just another statistic.
Kirchhoff, who also goes by DJ Myji, knew Chaidez through their shared love of music. Chaidez went by the name DJ Ozrock. Kirchhoff says Chaidez would do anything to help his family and friends. He fears that drive for helping others may have led him into danger.
He mentioned that to us. One of my friends that who's always just trying to look out for this girl, and I'm like, oh, I never met her. I don't know who she is. I don't even know how she fits into his world.
A world now without Chaidez, but maybe one step closer to knowing why.
I'm glad there's some sort of justice to fruition.
Catherine Cook, KGW News.
We're continuing to track a growing number of wildfires across Oregon, with people in three communities in eastern Oregon now on high alert. In Wheeler County, the Lone Rock Fire has pushed to within 5 miles of the town of Spray. Evacuation levels there upgraded to 3, which is go now. The fire has burned more than 83,000 acres, and while it's 40% contained, it still threatens some 240 homes. In Umatilla County, the town of Ukiah is under a level 2 advisory due to 2 nearby fires together called the Battle Mountain Complex Fire. 200 plus homes there are under threat. And in Grant County, people in the town of Seneca remain under a level 2 get set advisory as the 117,000 acre Falls Fire has spread out of Harney County and is now just over 10 miles away. The blaze has destroyed at least 11 homes, with 2,000 under threat. Altogether, 400,000 plus acres have burned across the state of Oregon so far this season. For perspective, that's more than 4 times the size of the city of Portland. During a briefing yesterday, Governor Kotek and other officials expressed their concern over this strong start to wildfire season. The state has already had 2 mega fires, which are wildfires over 100,000 acres. Leaders say we have conditions across the state more typically seen in mid to late August instead of mid-July, and a round of lightning strikes in the past week in tandem with hot and dry conditions have led to an outbreak of over 100 new fires. With nearly 90 areas under evacuation orders so far, the governor is urging Oregonians to be ready.
I cannot emphasize enough, this is a dynamic, fast-moving situation for our state, and we will continue to use every resource, every personnel that we can get our hands on to fight these fires.
The Oregon Department of Forestry also warned that the fires the state is dealing with may now just be the beginning. More possible lightning strikes this weekend could lead to more fires starting. Back in the metro, Corbett Fire says it had to use ropes and lots of water to quickly put a grass fire along the gorge under control. It happened around 5:30 this morning by the Vista House at Crown Point. It was a unique festival held today for a special group of people and their puppies in their care. Nonprofit Guide Dogs for the Blind held its annual fun day at its campus in Boring. More than 400 volunteer puppy raisers came out to celebrate, along with about 150 pups in training. These animals will grow up to become future guide dogs. The nonprofit says today's event is a small way to thank the work the puppy raisers do.
It truly takes a large community to support our mission, and it's really such an honor to, you know, have a mission that so many people want to contribute to.
And I love this. Today's celebration ended with several puppies meeting their raisers for the very first time.